In the previous post, I introduced the FIT principle and how researchers use it to study the effects of exercise interventions on vascular aging. I also illustrated why you will be unable to exactly replicate the intervention effects of any published study. So take these studies as a compass, giving you general directions, giving you vehicles to test drive on your way to the supernova league of vascular aging. In this episode, I'll show you 5 surprising conclusions that we can draw from those studies. And again, I will use the FIT components as our guide. Now let's start with frequency. There is this widely held belief that cramming a week load of exercise into 1 or 2 days on the weekend will do you more harm than good. Quite the opposite is actually true. A 2020 study on 1,700 middle-aged to older adults showed 2 things. First, the more exercise, the lower the pulse wave velocity. And second, there was no difference between the weekend warriors and the more frequent exercisers. The authors therefore concluded that from the perspective of arterial stiffness, engaging higher intensity physical activity, regardless of the weekly pattern, may be an important strategy to reduce the risk of cardiovascular disease. Which brings us to the next point. On first blush, it might sound like an uncomfortable truth. The harder you push yourself, the better the result. A 2014 review of randomized controlled trials concluded that the greater the intensity, the larger the cardiovascular benefits. The authors stated that all exercise modalities improve endothelial function significantly, and there was a significant positive relationship between aerobic exercise intensity and endothelial function. The good news is, if you amp up intensity, you can dial down the duration. Which brings us to the next component. In fact, you can reduce your time commitment to exercise and even get better results. The magic behind this is called HIIT, H-I-I-T, or High Intensity Interval Training. If you aren't familiar with the term HIIT, here is what it looks like. High intensity intervals alternate with recovery intervals. While there is no uniform definition of HIIT, high intensity means exercise between 85% and 100% of your maximum load. In the lab, we use incremental cycle tests to measure a person's maximum load. It works like this. We progressively increase the load on the cycle ergometer in a stepwise fashion. And your maximal exercise load is the highest load, expressed in watts, at which you can maintain a pedaling rate of about 60 rounds per minute for 1 minute flat, but not longer. In one of my next episodes, I'll show you how you can approximate your maximum load by testing yourself and how to use this knowledge to pace your exercise, your HIIT routines. There also is a more extreme version of HIIT called SIT, Sprint Interval Training. SIT utilizes the fact that you can sustain an intensity higher than the 100% for a much shorter period of, say, 15 to 20 or 30 seconds. Now back to the evidence. A 2018 study used 21 young sedentary men to compare the effects of 45 minutes moderate intensity continuous training, or MICT, with 4 minutes SIT routines. The men in the MICT group exercised 3 days per week, the SIT group 4 days per week. So the weekly exercise volume was more than 2 hours MICT versus 16 minutes altogether for SIT. And as you can see, the results were quite impressive. During their 7 20-second sprints, they maxed out at an intensity of about 170%, followed by 10-second recovery cycles. And trust me, that's a brutal 3.5 minutes. Now, the study demonstrated that by notching up intensity, you can realize the same benefits as with continuous exercise, but at a much lower time commitment. The beauty of HIIT is its versatility. You can apply it to virtually every aerobic or endurance type of exercise. And you can design the interval sequences in limitless types of configurations. As long as the high intensity intervals get you above the 85% threshold. A good beginner's configuration could be a 1 minute high intensity interval at 85 to 100% of max, followed by a 2 to 3 minute recovery interval. A session of 3 intervals makes for a 12-minute commitment to exercise. At 3 times a week, your total 1 hour investment may yield the same or a better pulse wave velocity dividend than the standard recommendation of 2.5 hours moderate intensity exercise per week. Of course, you won't know that until you start your very own biohacking self-experiment. Now let's look at strength training. Challenging your muscles is a sine qua non for preventing old age frailty. But challenging those muscles in the right way might also reduce arterial stiffness. A recent study observed that isometric strength training reduced the augmentation index, which is another marker of arterial stiffness, in healthy but sedentary men. Now I want to address one more exercise myth, the myth of the non-responder. A 2019 paper in the journal Sports Medicine summarized it as follows. The term non-responder should be replaced by low sensitivity. Low sensitivity individuals merely require increased volumes and/or intensity to drive a favorable response. In other words, if you don't seem to respond to some type of exercise, the author suggests you increase the volume and/or the intensity of that exercise. They forgot to tell you about another option. Try something else. Try something different. That's why my team and I have created the Lifestyle Navigator that we call Lilo. It is your tool to trial and error your way to the Champions League of supernova, of supernormal vascular aging. Now, after knowing that you can out-exercise a not-so-prudent diet, that you can't rely on replicating study results, and that there are time-efficient ways to exercise your way to stay biologically younger, what do you actually want to hear about next? Is it how biohacking your way to staying biologically young? That it is accurate, accessible, and affordable? Or do you want to hear more about time-efficient, low-volume exercise configurations, like daily exercise snacks, or inspiratory muscle strength training, or isometric strength training suitable for being performed at home? Or do you want to hear about whether too much exercise can reverse its benefits, and how to make sense of the conflicting evidence about extreme exercises? So tell me, and I'll cover the most voted for subjects in the next episodes. Stay tuned and see you then.